name is Max Kanat-Alexander, and I am a person, but also I am the author of a book called Code Simplicity, which is published by O'Reilly. I am the chief architect of the open source Bugzilla Project, and I'm a software engineer at Google, and I also do a bunch of other things. And that's my personal website there. That sort of describes a bunch of the other things that I do. And I guess what's relevant about a lot of this is that I'm going to talk a lot about software development today, and I actually do software development. That's what I do every day in and out. I'm not a researcher in an ivory tower. I am really in it with it just like everybody else. So today I'm going to be talking about software, and particularly software development and software design, which is the process of making decisions, technical decisions, for building your software. And you know, if there's anything that we know about software development today, it's that it's a little bit of a mess. You know, things are a little more complicated than they need to be. In particular, there's this very broad set of things that we're sort of taking for granted about software development today. In particular, we often take for granted that software has bugs. We just believe everything we write is going to be buggy and we're just going to have to deal with it and it's going to just be a problem. But in reality, there could be far fewer bugs in our software. It could be, it doesn't have to be nearly the same process that we go through now where we all just are resigned to unstable software. Another thing is that software development is much harder than it needs to be, and it requires a lot more thinking than it should. In reality, software development could be a lot easier than it is. And also, one other thing that a lot of people accept is that they'll just eventually have to rewrite their software someday. But in reality, you should be able to maintain one code base forever. There are situations in which you would probably have to rewrite, such as translating into another language. But in reality, you're probably that doesn't come up that often. And who knows, maybe someday we'll even solve that problem where you can rewrite into another language incrementally. So why is the state of software development the way it is today? Well, you know, many people would say, well, that's just because of the way it is. That's the way the universe works, is that these things are hard and you get through them and they're confusing and we don't, and you know, everybody has a different opinion about it. And to some degree, you know, it's true, everybody has a different opinion about it. But there are some underlying reasons why these things are this way. And this isn't all the reason, but this is one of the reasons. So if we go through this process, we see that the better you understand how to do something, the better you can do it. That's a fairly obvious statement. And then if you think about if there's a lot of people in an area who don't understand something as well as they could, there's going to be a lot going on in that area that isn't ideal. Now, I'm not saying that programmers are stupid and that there's something that they don't understand about software on a day-to-day basis. What I'm saying is that there are many, many programmers who don't understand everything that they could because there's a certain – you can only understand information if that information is available to you. You know, you can't learn things that you don't have available. And this means that – no, let me back up a second. So the problem is that there are no laws of software development. There's no underlying basic fundamental principles that were sort of all taught in school. Instead, we sort of learn the principles of software development by experience. Sometimes, you know, we read books and there's recommended practices and there's best practices, but there's a lot of these. You know, there's hundreds and hundreds of them. There's no, like, you know, few set of fundamental laws that we all learn. And because we all learn these things by experience or by reading a bunch of different things, sometimes there are gaps in our knowledge. And basically what this results in is that it results in a world where there's a lot of different levels of knowledge between programmers. And to some degree that's natural because people are going to have more experience than others, but to some degree it's unnatural because there's information that's not there to be had. That should be there. That should be there in easily digestible form. The very basics, the fundamentals, what are the laws of software development? And I just want to make a note here that I'm also not talking about object-oriented development only, because sometimes people say, well, you know, you didn't talk about such and such object-oriented principle. But I'm talking about all software development. So what we're going to talk about today is these laws of software design. And I'm really just going to give you a sort of a whirlwind tour of it. I have a much longer presentation that I do on this subject that goes into more depth, but this webcast has a certain limited length, and I promised that I would go over all of the laws and discovered that there was a lot more there to go over than I thought. So I've tried to compress it down and to leave some room for Q&A at the end. But there's a lot more information in the book, and there's a lot more information that I could go over, and there's also going to be future webcasts where I go over a lot of this in the future. That's fairly redundant statement. So one of the things that people tell me when I tell them these things sometimes is they say, well, that was obvious. I already knew that. But what I say to those people is that it's not important that you knew a piece of information, because we know thousands and thousands of pieces of information, particularly about software. The number of software development principles that exist out there in the world today are almost innumerable. What matters is that we find the most important pieces of data and pick them out of the sea. Once you pick out those pieces of information, you can build on them. You know that those are your base, and you can build more logical principles on them. And then when we all agree on those logical principles, we don't have to argue about them. We don't have to have long discussions about whether or not the fundamental principles of software development are true. Once we all agree, we can have really great group discussions in our software development teams, or even just, you know, in our forums or in our future discussions about best practices. And also, once you know what these ideas are, you can pass them down to future developers in the world of software development, because the world of software development is expanding at such a rate right now that there are always developers who don't have the experience that more experienced developers have. You know, many experienced developers have gone through very hard failures to learn some really important lessons. But if every single developer has to go through a failure to learn a lesson, then the entire world of software will be a continuous failure. And to some degree, that is part of the world that we live in now, is that there's a tremendous amount of failure going on in the world of software that there really doesn't have to be if the people who are engaging in that development understood certain fundamental principles about it. Finally, we can also judge new ideas. When somebody proposes a new software development methodology to us, we can judge whether or not that's valid, whether or not it's going to help us in our situation, not whether or not it's globally or universally true, because there's very few universal truths about software. But what matters is whether or not it's relevant for our situation. So the first of these big ideas, really important ideas, is the purpose of software. I wouldn't exactly say that this is a law. It's more of a guiding principle. It's more of a, it gives direction to these laws. Why would we even want laws? What are we trying to do? And you'll see this more as we get into the laws, and I'll talk about it a little bit more, why this is important. But the question is, can you come up with a single purpose for all software? And the answer is yes. The purpose of all software is to help people. Now, sometimes people say, what about viruses? Viruses are obviously harming people. This is true. So there's both an objective component to this and a subjective component to this. Objectively, you can look at this and you can say, okay, how many people does this software help? How much does it help them? But subjectively, you can say, who am I trying to help? Virus writers are even possibly trying to help themselves. Or sometimes, you know, I've seen interviews where virus writers say crazy things like, I'm trying to help people be aware of how stupid they are, or how much more they need to keep themselves safe, or what a dangerous world they live in. So every single piece of software can have its purpose phrased, often in a very short sentence, as to help people. And what I want to point out here is that it's not about helping the computer. That's what's really important. We're not, even when we're writing libraries, you know, we're writing some networking library to have two machines talk to each other, we're really helping programmers help those computers talk to each other. You know, the goal and the target here is always some person somewhere, or some group of people somewhere. And there's some question about, you know, what does the word help mean? Well, there's, you know, that's also partially subjective. You know, like I said, something that helps one person may not help another, but there's also the dictionary definition, which is to make it easier for a person to do something, often to do part of the work of a person. And this is often a very common thing that we think of. And when we're writing software, we think we're helping people do their work or part of their work, and I think that's very true. When you have a specific piece of software, that has a specific purpose. For example, accounting software has the purpose to help accountants do taxes. So you can see there's a particular thing you're trying to help people with, and then there can also be a particular group of people you're trying to help. Now we get into our first major law, and this law is called the equation of software design. What we're looking at here is we're looking at something called desirability for decisions, which is really a way of saying how right are my software decisions. Because what you want to do is you want to have take a bunch of decisions that you have, a bunch of choices that you have, and you want to rank them. There's no statement that any decision in software is absolutely right or absolutely wrong. When we have these holy wars about, you know, whether object-oriented development is better than functional development, or, you know, whether one editor is better than another, it's never, ever black and white. There's no, like, I am absolutely right and you're absolutely wrong. There's only, in some situations, some things are a certain degree better. There's a scale. There's a shades of gray. And so what we need to know is we need to know what shows up at the top of that ranking or near the top of that ranking. And the simplest way to think about this is that you take the value of the change, how much it will help anybody, versus the effort involved in making the change. However, this is an incredibly simplified version, so that we're going to get more into detail about this, and it's going to become more useful. But the very basis of it is this. And mostly you don't want to try to solve it with numbers, because it's very, very hard to throw numbers at value. It's easier to do it with effort, but it's also very hard to estimate, because you don't know all the aspects of effort. You don't know how long it's going to take to check in the change. You know, you don't really know how many discussions you're going to have around it. It's easier to estimate than value, but it's still difficult. So what we do instead mostly is we use this intuitively as software designers to pick out of a sea of possible decisions which ones we should be working on right now and what's our priority. Now, of course, one of the problems of the equation that you're looking at here is that it's static. It looks like, you know, every decision has just an immediate desirability value. But that's not true. In reality, there's also a time component, because we both implement our software and then we have to maintain it. And we both have users now and users in the future, which means that our software has a value now and also a value in the future. So really, the full version of the equation looks like this. It looks like the desirability is directly proportional to the value now plus the value in the future, and inversely proportional to the effort of implementation plus the effort of maintenance. And of course, the value in the future and the effort of maintenance are both functions of time. And occasionally people ask me, what do I mean by value now and value in the future? Well, mostly what I mean is value now is something that you get immediately. It's you know, you release a feature and then it helps 10 million people on the day of its release. But value in the future is, you know, does it also help that 10 million people tomorrow? Does it help fewer people tomorrow? Does it continue? Like, what's the rate at which it goes? It's a curve. Both effort of maintenance and value in the future are a curve. And because software has incredibly long timelines, what tends to happen is that if you look at this as a sort of a limit equation, that value now and effort of implementation are constants, whereas value in the future and the effort of maintenance are functions of time. And so as time approaches infinity, the constants tend to drop away, and we are left with the reduced form of the equation of software design, which says that the desirability of any decision is mostly proportional to its future value and its effort of maintenance, directly proportional to its future value and inversely proportional to its effort of maintenance. Now, there are situations in which the full equation from the previous slide is the most relevant. There are definitely situations in which the effort of implementation matters and in which the value now matters, but they are not the majority of software design decisions. I would estimate that 99% or more of all software design decisions boil down to the value in the future of the decision or feature that you're making versus the effort of maintenance of that choice. And, of course, that means that what you want is you want to avoid situations where there's a greater effort of maintenance than you're getting value out of it. And this is why we have software design. This is basically the entire purpose and the entire reason for software design to exist, is to avoid that situation. There are a couple of other, you know, useful reasons to have software design, but this is basically its biggest goal. And, of course, the ideal situation would be that you would have something where the future value increases and the effort of maintenance decreases. That's very hard, but it can be done. And then you have an increasing desirability as time goes on. So that's a great decision. But mostly, as long as your effort of maintenance is decreasing faster than your future value is decreasing, you're pretty much okay. So what you want to focus on mostly is making sure that you have an effort of maintenance that decreases over time. And this tells us it is more important to reduce the effort of maintenance than it is to reduce the effort of implementation. Now, many of us know this. We know it intuitively, or we've seen it by experience. But the great thing is that this gives us a very concrete way to both think about it and also to present it to others. Because we don't just have to make these decisions, but we also have to justify them to management and sometimes to non-technical management. And so this can be a really great way to go through and explain to people why the effort of maintenance matters. And it also highlights the really, really strong importance of this. And because occasionally when we're developing, it's easy to forget about it because we have deadlines, we have pressure. We think maybe we can get away with it. But really the equation demonstrates that you can't really get away with it, and that you're really going to end up yourself in trouble if you discount the effort of maintenance of your software. So basically, what that sort of tells us is that the future is really important, and we want to you know, plan for the future in some way or another. But the problem with the future is that it's long. It's really long. And there's some things about it that we can't predict. In fact, the further we go into the future, the harder it becomes to predict what's going to happen, including all of the consequences of our decisions. And software, in particular, has really long timelines. You know, usually you're working on a piece of software over months or years. As people tell me, well, what about, you know, sometimes I've heard about people hacking things up in a weekend and then they have a startup. Well, if that startup succeeds, then they're probably going to be maintaining that software for a very long time, longer than they expect. Usually you're maintaining a piece of software for longer than you expect to be maintaining it. And what this means is that there's far, far more in the unpredictable area of the future than there is in the predictable area of the future. And even the near future, if you try to make too specific a prediction about it, you could be wrong. In fact, programmers frequently attempt to predict specifics about the future when in fact they cannot know these things. They make statements like, we will always want to use MySQL as the database backend for our system. Well, that may be true. Or they say, you know, this part of the system needs to be really generic, even though we don't have any evidence of that right now, we just think, you know, in the future we might need to handle all kinds of input to this method, you know? Right now it just takes numbers, but it might also have to take strings, and it might have to take arrays of bytes, and it might have to do all these things, so let's just write them all now. But you're making a prediction about the future that may or may not be true. You actually don't know that information most of the time. Now, it's true that sometimes you have to make assumptions because, you know, you can't just not make any decision at all. But you have to be aware that you're making an assumption. You have to know, I'm making some decision about my software right now that may not actually be true, so I shouldn't put too much effort into it. I should be aware that this may change about the future. In fact, you're safest if you don't ever make a specific prediction about the future at all, and instead you make all of your design decisions based on things you know right now. The great thing about laws is that they tell you what's going to happen in the future no matter what. For example, the one we've seen so far, the equation of software design, you know, tells us that we're going to care about future value and effort of maintenance. We know that. We know that we want an effort of maintenance that decreases. We don't have to make some specific prediction about the future or what's going to happen tomorrow. You know, we don't have to say, oh, we're going to lose 5 programmers, so we need this to be easy to maintain. We know we want it to be easy to maintain no matter what happens. So one of the great things is that laws allow us to know certain things about the future right now without having to actually predict the future. And that explains sort of the contradiction between two of the things that I've gone over so far, one of which is that obviously the future is really important because, you know, there's the equation of software design. It says you care about the value in the future and you care about the effort of maintenance more than anything else. And then I've said, but don't predict the future. Don't plan for the future. And people say, well, this is a contradiction. No, it's actually not a contradiction. There's a difference between designing right now in a way that reduces future maintenance or that follows these laws or that, you know, you use the laws to make decisions versus attempting to predict something specific about the future. You know, I say something, like something very specific is going to happen tomorrow. You hear developers make these sort of statements all the time. They say, well, what if X happens and what if Y happens? Or you know, I think X is going to happen. You know, I think, you know, we're going to have 1 million users on day one and 500 users on day two. And really, you can make estimates in those areas, but you have to be aware that you're making a fundamentally unpredictable statement. And you always have to work with that idea that any guess you make about the future is a guess. So this brings us to our next law. So, you know, now that I've said that we can't really know too much about the future, what can we know about it? Well, we can know that probably the law of entropy is going to stay the same in the universe and that systems are going to change. that the universe around you, the environment around your software is not going to stay the same. And if you want it to continue to help people, see, this is where our purpose of software comes in again, you're going to have to change it. So this law says the longer your program exists, the more probable it is that any piece of it will have to change. In time, probably all of your software will change. Anybody who's worked on a system for 5 to 10 years has probably seen almost every single piece of code in that entire system change over time. There may be like a few lines that haven't changed, but I can tell you in Bugzilla, which has been around for about 14 years now, I don't think any of the original code survived, even though we're in the same language and we haven't rewritten. It's just a completely different code base. I know that I personally have contributed 90,000 lines of code changes to Bugzilla, and there aren't 90,000 lines of code in Bugzilla. And what this tells us most importantly is that it is impossible to make a system that doesn't change. You can't write a system and then hope that it will account for everything that could ever happen. This creates a design that's too rigid and that doesn't adapt to the future when it arrives. It doesn't help people in the future. The future value goes away. However, it's also bad to be flexible beyond what is reasonably necessary for future change, because this actually introduces a maintenance effort. When you add a bunch of code that you don't need, you are adding maintenance effort in the future, and you're adding implementation effort that you don't even need to have right there. And the point about both of these things, trying to make a system that doesn't change or trying to make a system that is too flexible, is that they're both predictions of the future. And I go into them a lot more in the book, and there's something called the three flaws of software design that developers engage in when they're trying to account for the law of change. They're trying to figure out ways to deal with the fact that their software is going to change. And, you know, a real brief thing is that I would say is that you should just accept that your software is going to change and then you're going to have to change it. But there's, of course, a little bit more to know about it than that. And there's also a lot more about it in the book. So our next law is the law of defect probability. And, you know, of course, we want to avoid defects because they violate our purpose. Defects are almost by definition, not quite, but almost by definition, things that don't help people. In fact, possibly redefining bugs in that way would solve a couple of arguments that people have had in the field of software development about whether or not a particular thing is a bug. This law is a law which I took from existing research, and so, you know, I have recently come to suspect that there may be more to know about it, because often existing research in the field of software engineering is not very good. Sometimes the data is good, but the conclusions are bad. Sometimes the data is bad. Sometimes the entire methodology of the study is bad. So I suspect that there may be more to know about this, but I know that this seems to have been working well enough so far. And that is that the chance of introducing a defect into your program is proportional to the size of the changes you make to it. Probably everybody's heard this. You know, you can't break things if you don't write code. But then, of course, you can't have features if you don't write code either, so what do you do? But basically, the important takeaway from this is that there are no perfect programmers. If you change your system, you're introducing the chance of breaking it. The normal statistics are that great developers introduce one bug for every 100 lines of code they write, and in the best possible circumstances, and we're talking military grade, mission critical, heavy, heavy process, extreme amounts of testing, systems end up with one bug per about 1,000 lines of code. So you can see that we need to change our software because that's what the previous law said, but if we change it too much, then we're going to break it. So we need some happy medium. And ideally that happy medium is one where you can change the software to account for the environment quite a bit without actually having to write too much code. Or at least without doing as many changes in the software. And we talk a little bit about size here. I just want to make a side note that a lot of what we mean is logical complexity. You know, we mean like how much are you actually doing? Because, you know, one concept in one programming language may take more code than it does in another programming language. And it's true that to some degree the amount of code that you're writing introduces the chance for typos and the chance for defects because, you know, there's just more you're typing. There's more areas you could get wrong. But there's also the idea that, you know, one concept in one programming language is the same as another concept in another programming language, even though they take different amounts of code to write. And so there's a sort of fundamental underlying logical complexity to each piece of code. And then that's part of what we're looking at here, too, possibly. This is a sort of a tentative hypothesis, the logical complexity thing, more than a law or a certainty at this point. Our next law is really the keystone. This is probably the most important law in software design. And it says the ease of maintenance of any piece of software is proportional to the simplicity of its individual pieces. In reality, almost every piece of software that you will work on, almost every serious piece of software of average size is so complex that no human being could possibly hold the entirety of it in their mind at once. Even something like Twitter, which is conceptually very simple, has, I'm sure, an enormous, enormous code base, which in its complexities is so complex that nobody could possibly think of how all of it works in their mind at once. And this is not a problem. This is the natural state of what we're doing. We're creating a system to solve a problem, and that even if the problem is simple, sometimes the system as a whole is complex because its complexity reduces the complexity of the problem externally to a sort of a simplicity for people. You know, I think in the case of Twitter, for example, the complexity of trying to send 140 characters to hundreds or thousands of people without Twitter is very high for people. But with Twitter, it's much easier. It's much easier for me to send out 140 characters to all of my followers. And so, you know, there's a lot of complexity in making that simple for people. So what we want then when we're writing software is we want that whatever the pieces are that we have to look at, you know, and whatever piece that we're up, and by piece I mean just a conceptual unit, any conceptual unit of the software. So often, you know, you mean a class or you mean a collection of classes in an object-oriented system, you know, or you mean a module in non-object-oriented systems, you know, or a set of functions. In a functional language. We want those to be comprehensible. We want those to be things that you can look at and understand. And in fact, you could possibly even define simplicity as how easily can this piece be correctly understood and used by others. Because when software developers are using software that exists, you know, they're dependent upon the other developer who wrote it to have made it clear both to read and to use. Because if it's not, then that's where you're getting into maintenance difficulty. That's where you're having a hard time understanding this particular piece of software. You're having a hard time using this to make new features. You're having a hard time not introducing bugs with it. You know, it's so complicated that every time you pick up this piece of code and try to do it right, it goes wrong. And most importantly, this tells us how to reduce the effort of maintenance from the equation of software design without having to predict the specifics of the future. There is a ton of stuff on this in the book, including where complexity comes from, a lot more about what I mean by simplicity. But like I said, today is the whirlwind tour, and so that's what we're getting on this today. Our final law is called the law of testing. And, you know, there's that famous quote from Donald Knuth about beware of bugs in the above code. I have only proved it correct. I have not actually tried to run it. And, you know, to some degree, and I've had discussions with people back and forth on this, you know, you can run your software through a verifier, and you can say, you know, I've proven that this software does what I think it does according to its spec. But that is, in a way, that's almost a form of testing. It's almost running your software in a fictional abstract world and seeing what it does. So even verification is a form of testing, although it's not quite as empirical as other forms of testing are that we engage in. The law of testing says the degree to which you know how your software behaves is the degree to which you have tested it. So many people think of testing as, you know, I test things and that tells me that it works. But what does works mean? I mean, works only means, really, it means that my software behaves in the way that I intended it to behave. It doesn't even mean that it behaves well or that it behaves in a way that users like. It means that it behaves like I intended it to behave. And that's what our tests actually tell us. Our tests actually tell us not, you know, works or doesn't work. They tell us this is how something behaves. And this sort of demonstrates to us why we need to test and what we need to test. You know, this explains, for example, things like, you know, why you don't test implementation details. Because implementation details don't really tell you too much about the actual behavior of your software. They tell you sort of, you know, what it's going through internally. It's like a person, you know, like when you're looking at a person and they're having some emotional difficulty, what you see on the outside is their behavior. You're not as concerned about what's going on internally unless you're trying to resolve it. You want to see, you know, what is the behavior of this person. And that's what you want to see in your software as well, which is a principle that, you know, many of us know if we have written a lot of automated tests or done a lot of testing. But it's interesting because this gives us the logical basis. And so you can see how there might be other really useful principles that you could extract from this law. So when I go over these things, people often ask me, what do I do with this information? You know, I have this information now, these laws, and also there's a bunch of other rules and guidelines in the book. You know, what do I do with these? Like how do I actually use them in the world? So I wanted to give you a couple of examples where we take questions that are traditionally thought of as sort of hard questions or things that, you know, people sometimes wonder about when they're doing development, and actually use these laws to lead us to a reasonable resolution for the situation that we're in. So a question that I've seen come up a lot lately is about testing. And when should I use mocks in a test? You know, and for those who don't know, a mock is it has various different definitions. But for the sake of this presentation, we're going to simplify it, and we're just going to say it's a way to fake out a piece of your software. You know, you say instead of getting information from the internet or over the network, just fake fake it using this file on the disk, or fake it using this string that I have in memory. So we have this question, you know, how often should I use mocks? When should I use mocks? Well, the first thing we need to look at is what's a test? Why are we writing tests? And the answer to that is the law of testing, which is the degree to which you know how your software behaves is the degree to which you have tested it. So what you know there is that you want to find out the behavior of your software. And in particularly, if you think about this a little bit, you might want to think about the behavior of your software as a whole. You want to think about, you know, like what's hard to test about software? Why are we writing automated tests? You know, like what are automated tests helping us with? And I'm sort of getting ahead of myself, but you know, they're helping us test the sort of combinatorial explosion of ways that our software could interact with itself, of the ways that all of our different classes or modules might, you know, be interfacing with each other. The number of possible different combinations of that is enormous, but theoretically, if we write good automated tests, we can really cover a lot of those cases, and we can know what that behavior is. So this gives us an idea that, you know, we might not want to mock things out if mocking them out will no longer tell us the behavior of our software. The second thing we know is that the longer our program exists, the more probable it is that any piece of it will have to change. If we're writing automated tests, this law includes those tests. Our tests are going to change. We are going to have to update our tests. So you know that if you mock out a piece of your system and then that piece of the system changes, you're also going to have to change the mock. So if you mock out too many things, you're going to have to update them. You might want to do that, but this way you can be aware of that. You're aware that you're creating a future maintenance cost. Finally, the purpose of software is to help people. Who are you writing tests to help? Well, you're writing tests to help yourself and other programmers. And what are you trying to help them do? You're trying to help them do many things. First of all, when on a day-to-day basis, when you're writing a piece of software, you want to run the test to know that it still works. So this also gives us an idea that a lot of these tests, particularly the ones that the developers are going to run on a day-to-day basis, should be fast. So this actually gives us a good reason to write mocks. You know, you want to mock out, maybe you want to mock out some of the slower parts of the test as long as they still give you a good idea of the behavior of your system, or as long as your entire test suite still gives you a good idea of the behavior of your system based on our law of testing there. But you also want to sometimes you also want to help QA if you have a manual QA department. You know, you want to relieve some of their burden. So this sort of, really the area where this came up when I was having the very first time I ever, well, maybe the 10th time I ever had this discussion, was, you know, is this test a unit test or is it an integration test? And my answer to that is that we shouldn't be too dogmatic about what words we're using for these sorts of things. And instead, we should go back and we should look at these laws and we should look at what we're actually trying to do. You know, what are we testing? What's our purpose? So you can see this gives us a really nice logical basis to actually have a discussion and come to a decision about a fairly hard question that has been really heavily covered by different people's opinions over time. Another situation that people wonder about and that I see a lot when I do code reviews is people think, you know, should I write this particular piece of code defensively? Should I, you know, my function, should it try to handle all sorts of unexpected input? So we have a couple of principles that can help us make this decision in any particular case. There's no universal answer to this question, just like many, many questions in software design, almost all questions. But there is an answer for the situation that we're in, and that answer should be fairly concrete. So we look at the first thing is we look at that the ease of maintenance of any piece of software is proportional to the simplicity of its individual pieces. If we're trying to handle a lot of different kinds of input, we're adding complexity, particularly input that we don't expect and that we know is not and that we're pretty sure based, you know, so I'm going to get into this in a little bit, but this is really a different answer if you're writing an external API versus you're writing some internal piece of your software. If you're writing some internal piece of your software, you're adding complexity to the system. And, you know, there might not be a really good reason for that because these things aren't going to happen. So you're increasing the effort of maintenance. You know, you go down and you look at the desirability equation here, and you say, what's the value that programming defensively is giving me? versus what's the maintenance effort that I'm adding. And even though sometimes it looks very small, if you make this decision wrongly too many times, then you end up with a very, very complex system. I've seen systems that did way too much defensive programming and that ended up being enormously, enormously complex. And became impossible to maintain almost purely out of that practice. However, there is another thing to take into account, which is that there are many unforeseeable consequences of the future. So if we're in a situation where we're writing an external API, we cannot predict what kind of input people are going to be giving us. You know, like when we're writing, you know, we're writing a web service or we're writing something that we're going to publicly export as the interface of our library, then in that situation, we look at it and we say, there's actually a lot of value here. There's a lot of value to programming defensively because we know that we can't predict the future. We know that we don't know what kind of input we're going to be getting. And so you can see here also, again, that you can take these principles and you can take this rather hard question that people tend to argue about, they get philosophical about, they have opinions about, and you can break it down into a much more concrete answer that hopefully, particularly once your entire team understands these principles, requires very little discussion or argument, and everybody can just sort of go about it sanely and have a good time. That brings us pretty much to the end of the part of the presentation where I talk. There's more information. I have a blog, which is linked there. You can also buy the book using that link or directly on O'Reilly's website. It's 50% off today, the ebook is. And then also, if you want to buy the print copy, there's a discount code that I can give you, which is AUTHD, auth D, which will give you 40% off the print copy. Finally, if you have any questions that I don't answer in this Q&A session that we're about to have here coming up, you can email me at max@codesimplicity.com. We're also about to set up some meetups on meetup.com for San Francisco, Mountain View, and New York. Where we're going to be discussing some of these principles and possibly, you know, how we can start improving the world of software design and software engineering and, you know, possibly do presentations, discussions, and these sorts of things. And there's also going to be another webcast on June 28th at 1 p.m. Pacific where I'm going to go more in depth into some of these principles. And with that, I guess we will turn it over for Q&A. All right, so let's look at the questions that we have here. Okay, so the first question that I see here is, how would you measure value in terms of VF and VN? In dollars? Well, it's dollars is one way to measure it. Really, you're looking at how do you help people? You know, what's the most helpful thing you can do? And a lot of the time, you get a return on helping people. So you can at least prove that your value is right. If you're in a commercial industry, by demonstrating that, you know, you got money back. But otherwise, you know, a lot of this comes into sort of the evolving quote-unquote science. I don't know if it's really a science, but it's really just more of a mathematical discipline of, you know, metrics analysis of software usage. You know, and this is one of the good reasons to sort of run experiments on users and to actually see what happens is because some parts of value are, although intangible, very measurable. You know, like, you've probably seen the things on the Google search where we measure, you know, we've done latency measurements and seen how many people start searching or stop searching. And so you can measure value that way. There's lots of ways to measure value. What you're trying, and the question you want to answer is, how do we know that we're helping people? How do we know that we're helping people now? And then how do we know that we're helping people in the future? So in the future is a slightly more abstract discussion, but you can know, you know, there's certain things you can know. For example, if I'm writing a piece of tax software, then the fact that it can do taxes is probably always going to be useful. You know, I feel fairly safe assuming that taxes are going to continue to exist on a broad level. But the tax laws for 2010 those are not going to be very useful for very long. So you can see that there's a sort of a decreasing future value. Sometimes you don't know the future value. Sometimes it's more of an unknown. But you can still get a very vague idea. Okay, this is a good question. So the next question is, how do you establish a rule of thumb to balance the time you put into the initial implementation effort versus future maintenance? That's a good question. So there's a couple of factors at play here. In an ideal world, you would put everything towards the effort of implementation and try to reduce the effort of maintenance entirely. However, there's a value to shipping your software. Software that does not ship has no value ever. So what you're doing then is you're actually balancing the effort of implementation versus shipping, basically. And so the rule of thumb that I would say is that I'm trying to think of a sort of a succinct way to phrase this. It's that you want to make sure that you're doing the right thing right now as much as possible, because the future is unpredictable and you really don't know what's going to happen, and so you want to try to make sure that you're going to have an ease of maintenance in the future. But you don't want to prevent yourself from shipping, so you need to look at your schedule, and that's what I'd do. I would balance effort of implementation versus shipping on a schedule, versus shipping on a schedule in the future. So if your effort of maintenance gets too high, then you're going to miss your future deadlines. So it's a balance that I would work out that way. Next question is, how important do you think it is to learn about software design patterns and anti-patterns to achieve code simplicity? I think it's really useful. I don't think it's absolutely necessary. I think somebody could achieve simplicity without them, but they're sort of a form of boiled down experience. As long as you don't look at them as dogma and you look at them as, oh, here's possible ways that I could use to resolve my problem in this situation, not here's something you always do, then they're really valuable data to use when you're making design decisions. I've almost found more value out of the anti-patterns than I have out of the patterns, because you can recognize anti-patterns very easily during code review and say, this needs to go away. But patterns can be very useful too. It just depends on the situation that you're in. Let's see. Question, do you have a law about documentation? Documentation to make it easier to understand the code? I would say, so there is a bit in the book about documentation, and what I would say is that documentation is a part of simplicity. Particularly, we're talking about comments, so there's different levels of documentation, right? There's comments, which should explain, why a particular decision was made, because that makes the code simpler to understand. And I would tie this all really into simplicity. I would say, if you don't have the source code, then it's almost infinitely complex to figure out how to use the software, and the documentation is critical to its simplicity. If you have the source code, then you may need less documentation, but you probably still need documentation, because it's probably simpler for the external user to read the documentation than it is to try to read all the code. Different communities have different philosophies about this. I remember in the Perl community for a while, there was a very sort of strong, you should just read the source code push. But I'm a big fan of documentation personally, in terms of reducing the complexity of understanding code. The next question. Can you say that your tests are your docs, or at least your interface documentation? This is a good question. I think what you're getting at there is, can you say that what you're testing is what the documentation says? And I would say usually, yeah. Usually that is what you're testing, because we're talking about behavior, right? And you set out a behavior in your documentation. But at the same time, there may be other forms of behavior that people expect anyway. sometimes, but particularly if the documentation is lacking, then, you know, obviously that doesn't really guide you in terms of how to write your tests. And so you have to think, you know, what do external developers expect? How would they expect this to behave? And actually, you are in a little dangerous territory when you're doing that, because you're starting to predict the future. But if there's no documentation, you have to do it. But that really does give you another good reason to write documentation, which is that it explains the expected behavior, and thus it makes the tests much easier to write, in a way. Although there's certainly testing situations that aren't covered by the documentation. You know, various different interactions between different methods and so forth that you want to make sure work, or you know, you want to make sure it doesn't deadlock. You know, I'm pretty sure that's a pretty good example. I'm pretty sure that nobody ever expects a method to deadlock, and usually people don't expect things to crash unless you've documented that they do. So, you know, you don't really need documentation most of the time to say those things, like this function doesn't crash, but your test should still check that. So next question is, the best design is the one that allows for the most change in the environment with the least change in the software. Would you be able to give an example for this? Sure. I think this is one of the great reasons for not writing spaghetti code. It's a really good example, I think. So if you take, I could give you specific examples. You know, there are definitely a lot of things that we did on the Bugzilla project, but it's hard to go over those sort of details in a webcast format. But I can sort of give you a general example, which is that when you have, you know, if you have a bunch of spaghetti code, so let's say you just have a file and it just, you're working in a scripting language like Python or Perl or Ruby, and you've just like written a bunch of lines of code and there's no functions and there's no objects and there's nothing. And then you do this 100 times, right? So the problem with that is fairly obviously that when the environment changes, when things change, you know, that you're trying to deal with, like let's say you're writing an inventory system for cars or something, you know, and you have all these different pages that deal with a car. You know, you're trying to keep track of like some company's fleet of cars, right? And then the company decides that it wants to also have trucks, and then you didn't expect that. Then you've got to make changes in, you know, 10 places, in 10 different files. And you possibly hundreds of lines of code changes. Whereas, you know, when you're using functions and you're using objects, I mean, this is a very, very sort of gross, broad example, obviously, right? Then you only have to change it in those functions or in those objects, and they, you know, and then the rest of your system sort of adapts automatically with much less change. And there's degrees of this, right? Obviously, you know, then as you can see, so the better you design and the better you do these, the better you make your functions and your objects or your modules or whatever particular method of reuse or design aspects or the language you're picking or the tools you're using. Although the better you use those and the better decisions you make, the easier it becomes to make these changes when you have to. Okay, so next, what part does performance or load testing play in the design? That's an excellent question. So when we're talking about performance, we want to think about performance not just now, but also in the future. If you make your software hard to change by prematurely optimizing it, by adding too much complexity to optimize it, then what's going to happen is that the environment is going to change. And I see this happen all the time, that people have very, very heavily optimized parts of their software that maybe didn't need it. And then the world changed, possibly their infrastructure changed, the libraries they were depending upon changed, you know, their feature set changed. And because that part was so hard to modify, they just hacked around it. And the hacks started to introduce performance problems. Whereas had everything been relatively easy to change, it would have been much easier for them to actually make everything still continue to be fast in the future. So the aspect that performance plays in design is that it's important that your software operate quickly in the sense of helping people. because you have to remember that the goal is to help people. So performance is still about helping people. It's about, you know, faster programs probably help people more than slower programs do, but that's not the only criteria in help. You know, maintenance, like making sure that your software still works in the future is also a really important criteria in help, possibly even more important than performance. But you can think about performance in terms of this. And then load testing. There's, you know, so some of that, some of this is the unpredictability of the future. I think, I mean, load testing is really important, particularly for a lot of the modern stuff that we're working on, where we're working at web scale and, you know, where we're making these massive systems that have to, you know, handle thousands or tens of thousands of requests per second or whatever. And, you know, we don't want them to fall over. But just like the performance thing, you don't want to try to over-design your system up front for this, because essentially what you do when you over-design your system up front like that, you try to make it a little too, you know, so okay, there's a difference between being scalable and being currently scaling. So you want to make a scalable system. You want to make a system that you could change in the future to scale, but you don't necessarily need to make it scale right now. You don't need to make it enormously powerful right at the start, because that involves a lot of complexity that then makes it hard to actually scale when you need to and when the world changes around you. But I would say that load testing is an important part of testing in that we're talking about behavior, though, in the law of testing. And one of the behaviors that users expect is that when they as an individual are using the software, that it continues to behave the same no matter how many people are using it. You know, and so that's also part of performance, right? You know, they expect a certain number of seconds before the program responds to them. And they expect that certain number of seconds no matter how many users are using the software. So that's how I would come at load testing. I would come at it from the perspective of expected behavior, just like every other test. And I believe that is the end of our questions. Yasmina, is there anything else?
There are actually just a couple more questions that have come in. There's a refresh button right above your Q&A. If you can click that, it should give you a fresh
I'm sorry, Yasmina. Actually, I had my headphones off. Could you say that again?
Sure. Sorry about that. We do have a few more questions that have come in. There is a refresh button right above your Q&A panel.
Oh, wow. Quite a few more questions.
Yes, and folks, we're going to take just a few more questions, and we'll answer as many as we have time for. Back to you, Max.
Okay, cool. So what's your opinion about applying aspect-oriented programming for making code more maintainable or more obscure? So my current knowledge of aspect-oriented programming is actually a little lacking. I have done some research on it, and I do understand the fundamental concept. I think it's, you know, it's a tool, and just like any other tool, if misapplied, it causes you trouble. You know, like if you try to nail in something with a screwdriver is possible, but it's not easy. You know, when you have some sort of cross-cutting concern and you're trying to, you know, you want to make that. Then, you know, aspect-oriented design is possibly a helpful solution. But you might also, you know, sometimes you start to wonder if you have cross-cutting concerns, then maybe something is wrong. Not always, you know, sometimes you have cross-cutting concerns and they're valid, but I become somewhat concerned that sometimes aspect-oriented design is attempting to resolve a problem that shouldn't be there. But sometimes it is, you know, sometimes you have certain things like, you know, authentication modules and so forth that sort of cut through everything. And it's nice to sort of have the beginnings of some pattern for that. I don't know that the discipline is totally well evolved yet enough, particularly in mainstream development, to really be able to make a judgment about it. Okay. Can you compare different dependency injection approaches for simplifying or complicating code? Convention versus configuration? Sure. So, yeah, this is really an interesting question. The whole convention versus configuration question, this is once again a specific situational thing. But, I mean, I'm a big fan of convention because it makes everything simple. But at the same time, if the convention prevents you from doing what you need to do, then that makes life complicated. So that's really where I draw the line, you know, is where you when you need something that the convention doesn't provide, then you need configuration. You know, so like, for example, like there's web frameworks like pylons where they give you a default set of things, but if you don't like that default set of things, you can swap them out. And I believe Rails 3 also allows you to do that. And so I think that's sort of the healthy balance. I mean, I could go more into dependency injection in particular in terms of testing and so forth. I think that would be a longer discussion. And I think I sort of handled the general convention versus configuration question. Okay. So, question. Best/worst ways to encourage other devs to apply these principles. Well, one of the reasons that I wrote the book is that I was hoping that the book would be a really good way to encourage people because it sort of walks people through the whole logical process of understanding these things, and it makes it very clear and simple. So I'd like to think that that's the best way, and I hope that that's not too self-promotional of a statement. There's numerous ways. So the ways that I accomplished it before I had the book was that I just started applying these principles in my code reviews, and I got much more strict about doing my code reviews. And people would fight back a little bit at first, but then I would a little bit ignore their complaints. I would acknowledge their complaints, and I would say that I understand what you're saying. But I would also I would mostly ignore their sort of their objections to writing good code. You know, like, oh, I have to ship this. Well, you don't have to ship it tomorrow. You know, you can spend 2 or 3 more hours to do this a little better than you did it. Probably the worst way would be to try to just present. So the worst way is just to tell people the laws and not explain them, because they look at you like, what? What are you talking about? I don't get it. I've had very little success with that. Also, another bad way is that if you don't apply them yourself and you try to convince other people to do them, then they're not going to believe you. I hope that answers that. So the question is, what sorts of language are best used to express a software design, code or not code? Put another way, is there anything more to a software system than the code that implements it? Well, that's a really good question. Wow, that's a great question. Most of the time I just write code, and a lot of the other times I draw things out. I think if you're getting to the point where you're trying to describe the whole system, then you're probably designing too much up front. And, you know, if you're doing something that can't be, like if you're just doing, like you should be just designing a part of the system and trying to draw out, you know, that part, like on a piece of paper if it's too complicated. To be honest, I don't think I've ever run into a system that was so complicated that I couldn't just draw it on a piece of paper. Or a part of a system. A whole system, sure. The whole systems are so complicated that you could, I mean, drawing them out is really hard. You know, I mean, people used to write UML diagrams, and that was like, you know, that's like a lot of work. and maybe not, doesn't get you a lot sometimes. But I would say that for very simple things, code is the best way to describe it. And for slightly larger things, diagrams are what I would do. But the sort of broader question, is there anything more to a software system than the code that implements it? Yes. Software is knowledge. It's fundamentally a solid form of knowledge. It's ideas. It's logic made real. and underlying that is the logic, is the knowledge, is the concept. It's an idea, basically. and that's, you can actually think of software that way. And that is really what underlies it, and that's really what underlies these designs, is a series of logical things. Huh. The one guy says, thanks, Max, I just ordered the book. Oh, thanks. That's fantastic. So next question is, how does generated code factor into all of this? That's a great question. Generated code, as long as you don't have to maintain it by hand, I would say you can worry a lot less about its complexity. Because, you know, when we're talking about complexity, we're talking about and we're talking about maintenance problems. And generated code doesn't necessarily have as many maintenance problems. You have to understand the complexity, you know, the difficulty of generating it and so forth, but it can be a useful tool to handle sort of, you know, to handle complex situations. You have some simple code to generate some complex code. Oh, I see Yasmina is thanking everybody for attending. Does this mean that we are out of time for questions today?
Oh, we can answer the last one that came in.
Okay, great. So we have one more here. When do you know when you should push it live? How complete / polished should it be before you let people test it? Oh, the question of the ages. that is a really good question. And that could possibly have its own entire presentation. My girlfriend is an entrepreneur, and I talk about this with her a lot too, because she's in the startup space. I'm trying to think if there's a way that I can answer this question succinctly in the space that I have left in this talk. When do you know when you should push it live? Well, okay, so the first thing you want to approach this as is the equation of software design. Is that statement that I made before about software that doesn't ship has no value. You also want to look at it as an issue of the unpredictability of the future. Is that sometimes you think something is going to be valuable and then you push it out and it isn't. So you don't want to put a huge amount of implementation effort into things that you don't know are valuable or not. At the same time, you don't want to push something out that's going to cause negative future value no matter what you do. For example, you never, ever, under any circumstances, want to push out code that has security flaws, or particularly security flaws that would allow you to and it would allow people to steal user data, right, or that would put you at legal risk. So you can see that as an extreme example of things you wouldn't want to push live, even though they're in a bad state. Some of this varies also on your release cycle, right? So when you're working on the web and you're just a piece of web software, one of the great things is that, you know, you push things and everything is on your server. You know, you can change it, you know, really quickly if you have to. So if you make a really bad mistake, you can take it back. But if you're shipping software, like, you know, Bugzilla, we were in one of the worst possible situations. We were shipping software to servers that might sit there for a really long time. And so we were in a different situation. So a lot of this depends on whether or not you're shipping versus whether or not you're centralized. And so, you know, when you're shipping, you need to be a little more polished because some of this also depends on your update mechanism, right? You can think of it that way, right? Like if you have a forced update mechanism where everybody gets it quickly, it's easier to throw out things that are unpolished. But when you have no update mechanism or an update mechanism that people have to opt into, right, like iOS, then you're much more at risk and you have to be much more careful about how polished your stuff should be. But that also puts you at a somewhat of a disadvantage because you don't get that user feedback as quickly. So you don't understand, you know, you're getting less feedback about the value. You're not getting as much data, you know, because what you want, when I'm talking about you don't want to predict the future, a lot of what I mean is you want data. You want to make your decisions on data, on real information. And when we're talking about features, the real information is your users. A lot of the time, it's, you know, and I'm not saying to do what they say, I'm saying to get information from them, right? Get the data, make decisions on the data. And if you don't have the data and you're making too many predictions about the future without the data, then you're in a really risky situation where you could be, you know, you could be doing an enormous amount of effort to actually create something that has no value now and no future value, or very low future value and very low value now. So the more quickly you can push out, the more quickly you can get data back from your users, but you also have to balance that against, you know, the risk of negative future value and, you know, your update mechanism and other ways you can help or not help people. That's what I would say as a very, very basic answer to this question. All right.
Alrighty, I'm not seeing any additional questions, Max. We're going to say a big thank you to you for presenting such an outstanding webcast today and for sharing all your knowledge and expertise with us. Folks that attended, thank you so much. We hope you benefited from today's webcast. We'd like to remind you all, Max's book is the O'Reilly Deal of the Day. That means you can get it at a great price today. If you like what you heard, you need to get that book. There's a lot more in there that's really going to help you. O'Reilly.com, look on the right-hand side. You can't miss it. Again, thank you, Max. Thank you, everyone. This will conclude today's webcast. Goodbye, everybody.
Goodbye.